Hi, everybody. Good morning. My name is Steve Rosenthal. I have a preservation and archive business in New York called Mars, which is the Magic Shop Archive and Restoration Studios. Before that, for 30 years, I owned the Magic Shop, which was a studio on Crosby Street in New York. We made lots of cool new records, and then in the basement we would do lots of preservation projects. And I have been involved in a large number of archiving and preservation projects with estate, family estate owners. And also, of course, done a number of them with major label people as well. So it's something I really care about. I really enjoy learning about the past, and I think the more we know about it, and the more it informs how we can deal with our assets here in the future.
Mike. Michael Graves. I'm a mastering engineer based in Los Angeles. I specialize in audio restoration and preservation, and I sort of started off as just really being fascinated with the idea of taking old damaged recordings and cleaning them up. That sort of led me to work with record labels that deal in that sort of thing, like Dust to Digital, War Recordings, Numero Group, and Log Africa. There's a lot of damaged media out there that needs to be cleaned up, so that's sort of what I do. And then that's also led me to deal with, just like Steve, estate archives, corporate archives. There's these repositories of sound with aging media that they're not quite sure what to do with and how to handle it going forward.
My name is Brandon Bush, and I am primarily a musician, and my day job is playing in a pop country band, Sugarland. My other day job is managing an archive of materials that we have a recording studio and a publishing company. And so what I tend to do, and I think where I'm relevant here, is my job is to maintain a whole slew of content that's being made every day, with the eye towards preserving it for the future.
And I'm Cheryl Pavelski. After wending my way through the major labels to whom I still consult, about 10 years ago I started Omnivore Recordings. And we, although we do release some new records that are tied to the artists that we work with on a historical or catalog basis, we're primarily a catalog label, or historical label. So we wanted to pull this together to really talk about how we're situated for the future, because we've got cloud solutions, we've got drives going bad, we certainly have DAS and CDRs evaporating, but we also have a situation where analog recording tape will probably, if it's stored properly, it will outlive all of us. It's expensive these days to transfer materials to that, and it might not be an option for independent artists. And so we just wanted to kind of throw a spotlight on that and start a discussion that will hopefully go beyond this room, so that the artists of today know how to set up their archives for reissues tomorrow. We don't know, you know, when CDs came in, it was the end all be all. And now digital, oh, it's the end all be all. There will be another configuration. One of us, hopefully, will figure out the next physical configuration because we'll make a lot of money.
No, this is
a
different name.
This is
so
the new one.
We're really
okay.
Fortunate. Well, Cheryl, I've been really fortunate to work with Cheryl because she brings these amazing projects to me, and I get to try to do what I do with them. But Hank Williams has been, we've done a lot of Hank Williams, and this was from an acetate. No, it's a transcription disc.
Should I play?
Yeah.
Darkfield just saw my rules here a few years ago. This man got out of his wife, he's the only one here to the man. The door is on. The fact of it is, I'm a long, long day.
So, that is.
Darkfield.
That was the original audio transfer.
That's the original record played with a standard needle, and that's just transferred right there.
And that's Health and Happiness shows.
Right, Health and Happiness.
Okay, that just came out, right?
So the first part of audio restoration for that kind of thing, people think of audio restoration as like these digital tools that we use to get rid of pops and clicks, but there's so much of audio restoration that has to happen before it even gets digital. If we're dealing with anything, a grooved disc, so it could be an acetate or record or 78 or whatever, the needle choice is so important, because if you choose a wrong needle, there's no amount of digital restoration that can fix that. It's like if you're recording somebody and you have a damaged microphone, once that's recorded, you really can't fix that. So it's all about how you pick it up. And so that also translates into a good turntable that has a good solid rotational speed. And then your analog chain, make sure you have a nice clean analog chain, because once you capture that digitally, that's what you have to work with. So that first set, that first recording was with a standard LP needle and a pretty good, probably better than average turntable. Then this was played, the next one was with an appropriate needle, and then I've done on my audio restoration.
There was a song that I wrote here a few years ago. The man got tired of his wife beating him on the head with a frying pan, so he wrote a song. The title of it is, I'm a Long Gone Dad. I think there's something wrong, so I'm leaving now. I'm leaving now. Well, I'm a long song, Daddy. I don't get you anyhow.
Let's just listen to that.
So a lot of times we think, people think that if you want to do the historical deep dive in somebody's catalog, you just go back to tape. Well, let's remember that tape wasn't used until the late 40s or early 50s. So the first 50 years of recorded history is all on some sort of group media. So that's what you have to work with. So a lot of times, like Hank, when I see something like that, I know pretty clear from the beginning that I can make this sound like it came off of a tape. With shellac and cylinders, there's only so much you can do. But and that goes like if you're an artist from the 70s or 80s, and you've got a vinyl pressing, but you don't have your master tapes. If you've got a good clean copy of your record, it can end up sounding like a master tape once.
And working on it here on our archives is the legendary jazz pianist who's passed away in the 70s, but over the last 5 years we've done a whole series of new issues of recordings. This year we're putting out 12 Garner records, one a month. His whole catalog, post-CBS catalog. But when we first dove into Errol's world, we realized that there were storage lockers filled with other goodies besides music. There were 3,000 tapes, but there were also photographs. There were Errol's wardrobe. There were contracts. There was an enormous library of information pertaining to
20 records, yeah. Jazz records that you put out, you know, are worth something later. How do you know if it's going to be valuable?
Yeah,
and that's the big question, right?
At the mercy of somebody, like Steve's talking about, you know, you're at the mercy of avid. But if you put it on tape, you're at the mercy of the tape manufacturer. The tape might last forever, but the manufacturers of those heads, you may not be able to find them. So it's really tough. It's a tough.
I think you know redundancy is like an overused word in like the tech world, but I think in the preservation world, it's a really important thing. You know, as many redundant copies as you can have of your assets, in terms of some sort of analog solution. I do a bunch of work at the Library of Congress, and they still make 15 IPS two-track copies of stuff, and along with 24 192s and cloud solution. So I think, you know, redundancy of backup is really important. And there is no, silver bullet idea which will make your assets safe. One thing, when I used to work on the Stone stuff, and one thing I always encouraged them to do was to not keep it all in the same country even. I was like, let's send a set of these to Europe. Let's send another set to Japan. Let's have, well, you can have one in Ireland if you want, but I think that's also an important thing, if you can figure out how to separate them so they will be safe.
Get one in international waters.
Yeah.
I mean, this.
Yeah, exactly. 60-page
document. Yeah, yeah.
It's a page.
Well, there you go.
Did you back it up?
Yeah.
The keys to the kingdom.
Yeah.
Even that, those are best practices. But after I read that, I was like, I've got marching orders now. I've got a clear path of what I'm going to do. But then I started working with other entities, and they have a different. They're not down with that. So it is just crazy.
You know? I think one thing that we have to talk about and speaks to that is that there's a conflict there between budget and preservation. Yes.
Right.
So you want to do the right thing because you're seeing all of this stuff being created and you're like, oh man, this is going to get lost. And then you have these budgetary constraints, right? And that push-pull thing goes on all the time in the things that we do. I'm always asking for more money for preservation projects and trying to make the box sets bigger and things like that. But there is this really tough part of this where you have the financial constraints on what it is that you're doing.
Michael is promoting the arts best practices.
And you're trying to future proof, but also, when you come up with, let's just call it a program like that for the time being, the proclivity is always to build it for now, but then they immediately turn around and look back at our world and go, okay, now we can build it back and have all of this information. And they just don't realize how complete.